Hello, this is Pastor Sandra Kennedy here at Whole Life Ministries in Augusta, Georgia. We are so excited about what God continues to do here. He is a wonderful, miracle-working God. We just see Him doing so many things. We believe we're in an entirely different season with God. So many things are happening, and they ought to be happening at your church too, because I'm telling you, this is a great time for those of us who are part of the kingdom of God to rise up and let God be God. This is our very finest hour. And you are going to love my guest today. I've known Dr. Sue Kern and her husband, John, for many, many years. Matter of fact, so many years, I don't even want to count that far. And they have been wonderful friends. And Sue, of course, has written many, many books. And she has a new book out that I think will absolutely change your life. And I'm just honored that she's here. Sue, thank you for being here.
Well, thanks for letting me share today. I appreciate it.
You know, we've been friends a long time.
Thank God.
Thank God. And you and John have been wonderful to this ministry. Y'all been a part with us almost from day one for so many years. Mm-hmm. And it's wonderful to have those kind of relationships through the years. And I am so thankful for y'all and what I've seen God do in your life and watch the kind of ministry that God has given you. It's been phenomenal. Matter of fact, I remember Sue and her husband, Pastor, in Shekinah Ministries, which is a conference center, how would you explain your place? It's so big, and y'all got so many things going on. And the first time I ever heard about you, Sue, was years ago with all the worship seminars that you used to mm-hmm. do, and of course, and heard how God visited you through prayer.
Yes.
And the great, and which we're going to be talking about with your new book here. Mm-hmm. But I mean, not only do you have a church there, but a conference center and right. so many facilities. Mm-hmm. It's amazing.
Well, it was a part of the original vision.
Uh-huh.
The Lord spoke to us.
You were a good old Methodist girl, weren't you?
I was. Uh-huh. And I learned a lot from the Methodists, and they were good to us. You know, some
right.
of the folks really helped us with our ministry. But then when I got baptized with the Holy Spirit,
uh-huh.
the Lord spoke to us and He said, I want you to build me a place where the commandments of Jesus will be a reality in everyday life.
Praise God.
We knew in our spirits that we needed to be free to do what God called us to do. So centered around the local church, mm-hmm. it became a conference center and a training center. We mm-hmm. had a Bible school on campus right. for 10 years. Mm-hmm. And then we began to build Bible schools in other nations mm-hmm. as well.
Right.
So, and we've done TV and right. radio, and I've traveled extensively to the nations. And God has really favored us to let us be a part of doing things where He's moving.
Well, I know you've written many books, but I know that something's very special about this because it really goes back to the basis of who you are.
Mm-hmm.
Her new book is called Define Your Destiny Through Prayer, and it's just about to be released. It's just wonderful. And I see that our friend, Dr. Miles Monroe, did the
yes.
your forward here. And Your Journey to Divine Revelation. I want y'all to turn up your television or however you're listening here, because Dr. Curran really has walked in many places through the spirit dimension, and God has taught you many things. But I think the nugget that so rings in my how years ago you had a, what I would call like a revelation of a revival of prayer. Is that what you'd call it? That God just invaded your place, didn't He?
He did. That was in 1980.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, the Holy Spirit just moved in on us one Sunday morning after I prayed and stayed with us, and we were praying night and day for 4 months.
My goodness.
Intently. And then that move of the Spirit continued for another 4 years.
My word.
And this is how we evaluated it. In that four-year period of time, I personally never heard one person say a negative word about another person.
Now that is a miracle.
It is a miracle. That's why I mentioned
yeah.
it. The whole atmosphere changed.
Through prayer.
It was through
But it was
prayer.
It was a divine visitation from God, wasn't it?
Yes, it was sovereign.
Sovereign is the word I'm hunting.
Sovereign
Holy move
Ghost
of God.
Revival. Uh-huh. And then it continued, and the Lord taught us. It actually began because we were seeking Him in prayer, but also it was sustained through prayer.
Mm-hmm.
so that prayer became the essence of the revival. And out of that revival came every major ministry then that he called us to, conference ministries and building these Bible schools and worship conferences, all these things you mentioned that we did as well.
Well, I know that people have come literally from all over the world to be a part of your ministry, and Dr. Curran and her husband, John, they are known as prayers, and that church is known as a praying place, and that's the reason I'm so interested in finding out, because when you talk about your journey to divine revelation, this is about your life and what you learned basically from prayer and where God took you, and again, matter of fact, one of your first books that you wrote, the one on prayer that we use here constantly,
The Praying Church.
We made it a requirement of our church members to read that book, and it really was a foundation. We are a praying church, and that prayer has been a sustainer. That book has been a sustainer for this ministry, and I'm sure many ministries, but it certainly has been for us. And then to see you come through here with... to write another one about what you have learned and to take us on this journey. Does it take us all the way back to how you started?
It takes you right back to my very first prayer that I borrowed from a Methodist minister.
Well, tell us about it, Sue. Because I know you know about prayer. You've prayed yourself through many of things, haven't you?
Yes. Well, we were in revival, and we didn't realize it. This was not in 80. This was in 73 when we first, before we even started our ministry.
That's the year God called me.
Really?
Uh-huh.
Well, I find that so many wonderful things were happening at that time. You know, that's when the Jesus movement occurred. And so these young people had gotten saved. My husband and I were youth pastors. Never mind, we weren't saved at the time.
Yeah, I understand.
But we found out later what it meant to really be saved. So we got saved on this retreat. And then since we were in revival, we went to these Methodist churches 17 straight nights in a row. And revival broke out. I didn't even know to call it revival.
Yeah, yeah.
And so these young people came to the altar and they said, we want what you have. And of course, what we'd gotten born again. A lot of people are in churches, mean well, but they haven't had the born again
experience.
They have
not. They're just sitting there riding on somebody else's coattail.
Really. Mm-hmm. And so because I didn't know how to pray because I'd just gotten saved myself, youth leader that I was, these young people came forward and they were just crying their hearts out. And I listened. I moved over where this old Methodist minister was praying with some. Mm-hmm. And he prayed, "Dear Lord, look favorably on this one who has come tonight." And I thought, that's it. That's what to pray when somebody comes. So I prayed that prayer over about 25 kids. That's my first prayer, was a borrowed prayer. And then after that, I had to learn to pray to survive. You see, the Holy Spirit rescued me because I got in way over my head in the ministry God called us to, 160 acres,
and
to develop this ministry, you know, based around the local church. And
you're a woman.
And I'm a woman. There would be a little bit of resistance there.
Yeah.
But I understood that it was going to take every kind of miracle in order to accomplish this.
Right.
And I didn't know how to have miracles, but the Holy Spirit rescued me by teaching me how to pray and also by gifting me with the gifts that I would need to operate in the Holy Spirit
me. How did He teach you to pray?
Well, as I would come to each situation, I would just come before the Lord and I would say, "Lord, you know that I can't do anything unless you show me, unless you teach me." And Romans 8 says that the Holy Spirit will teach you how to pray, and He will pray through you.
Right.
And so He did both of those things. That is really the key, is He taught me how to pray, and He prayed through me. I began to sense the anointing of the Holy Spirit.
And to recognize His voice?
Yes, and to hear His voice. And sometimes He'd cause the Word to live. Now we know that's a rhema word.
Right.
And when that Word would live, then I'd know I had it. And I'd jump on that.
Right.
And because there was such a great need, and because we were obedient to God, He sent the Holy Spirit to rescue me by leading me and showing me how to do these things.
God is so good.
Isn't it wonderful?
He is a good God. You know, I was telling someone this very day on the phone, I said, you just have to turn to God and you have to believe He's going to get you through.
That's
and
true.
Praise Him, because He's an unchangeable God, and we all have gotten through a whole bunch of things before.
Yeah.
And you just have to know He's unchangeable and He'll always be there. Mm-hmm. What made you write this book?
Well, I have been aware that so many people are intimidated, the very thought of prayer. And so there are people who know that I've written some books on prayer.
Right.
And I thought it would be appropriate for me to write something taking them back to when I was intimidated by prayer.
Yeah.
And when I really didn't know anything about it, but if I hadn't learned, I wouldn't have survived.
Right.
And one revelation built on another. And when we would need financial miracles, then the Lord would show me out of the Word the right way to pray for finances. He showed me how to take authority over the enemy that was trying to rob us of our finances.
Okay, I'm going to interrupt you a second.
All right.
All right, because I want to ask you something. So you're telling me that there are different ways you pray for different things.
Yes.
So that's why some people don't break through.
It's really true. You know, okay. There's the prayer of intercession.
Uh-huh.
There's devotional prayer that's every morning as you come before the Lord and pray and give your heart to Him, and that's when I really hear from Him in the mornings.
Right.
Scripture says, morning by morning thou awakenest mine ear.
Uh-huh.
And so if you learn to hear God, it sets you up for the day.
Uh-huh.
Then, you know, there's strategic praying.
Is that being just quiet and begin to hear down in here?
Well, it's letting God talk. It's not
okay.
doing
not
all the
you
talking.
It's
both.
Okay.
And it's worshiping and loving Him, mm-hmm. then opening yourself to hear from Him. And then
so you got to be quiet to hear.
You have to. I mean, if you're just talking at God all the time, then you're not hearing what
right.
He's saying. That's really important.
Yeah. So what is different about this book than your other prayer books?
Well, the other books take you from to another level.
Mm-hmm.
The Praying Church would take you to a level where you could pray as a corporate church.
Yeah.
And
prayer, man, has that book helped us,
I'm
Dr.
so
Curran.
Glad.
That's a
I'm
wonderful
so
book. That is a wonderful book.
And people like it because it's not, it's written in a very simple way.
Yeah.
Actually,
that's the reason I liked it.
The Holy Spirit led me to write that book.
Yeah.
I would not have written it otherwise.
Uh-huh.
And then I wrote Prayer in Another Dimension about learning to pray strategically and about learning to become more fervent in prayer and praying like I had learned around the world in other countries where they seem to be getting more miracles and more answers to prayer.
How have you, did you take the, for lack of a better word, did you take the basic nuggets out of all of these and put it here?
Mm-hmm.
Is that what you've done? To take what you've learned through all of these years?
Through my experiences.
From your experiences and put your own personal experiences in.
Exactly.
And what you have learned, not only what you have seen here there, but like, did you start down to from the beginning here?
I started right in the beginning.
Uh-huh.
Right when I didn't know how to pray, and then I took us into a revival that where we came into a totally different realm because we prayed all the time.
Uh-huh.
And then I moved
When you say we, you mean your whole church.
I'm talking about the whole church. It was a sovereign Holy Ghost move of God.
Yeah.
And the Lord wanted us to have that experience so that we could teach other people how the Holy Spirit, if you make a place for Him,
right.
He will come, and then you can pray for Him to extend His visitation with you.
Yeah.
And people can, any of you listening to us today, everybody can pray on some level. I just started not knowing how to pray and took little baby steps. And then the Holy Spirit began to teach me. Then He showed me how to allow Him to pray through me. And then I learned, even in toward the end of the book, that I gave experiences in the mission field and where we saw miracles accomplished there, you know. And I talk about ways that the Lord had delivered me from plane crashes and all kinds of different things that can happen.
Yeah.
How the blood of Jesus is used and the name of Jesus
Whoa, back up and tell us some of those things there. I mean, you learned how to pray your way through desperate situations.
Mm-hmm.
I know you prayed your way through desperate health situations.
Yes, exactly.
Financial situations.
Mm-hmm.
And now you're telling me through praying out of plane crashes and out of just... And then Tell me about it.
Well, we had a
So prayer is the key to all of it.
Yes. I had a very special intercessor praying for me when I went to India once.
Uh-huh.
And she saw my airplane diving into the ocean, and she jumped out of bed in the middle of the night and prayed the rest of the night. And what actually was happening at that very time is that the plane lost its engine.
My goodness.
It's a large plane. Uh-huh. And the plane that had done that before crashed.
My goodness.
The engine cracked and it would have gone into flames. But we landed safely. And I found that you can have a prayer covering like that. That was so wonderful. And then I got sick in another country one time.
Right.
And really the Lord taught me to worship my way out of that.
Absolutely.
To just love Him and let Him come and presence Himself. And even in when I've needed healing, and even more recently, He's taught me different things about healing. The Holy Spirit keeps teaching me these things.
Because He's the healer.
And He keeps teaching me how to pray.
Yeah.
How
yeah.
I should pray.
Yeah. Well, you know, all of you who are listening, key little thing she says I keep picking up on, there are many a person out there that think that they don't have a ministry because all they do, quote, is pray. They can't go to church, do this. I keep telling people, pray. If you want to do anything for me, pray.
Absolutely.
Pray for me. And you made a very interesting statement. It's the intercessor. Mm-hmm. They may not even know what that word means, Dr. Curran. They may not even have an understanding of that. But in general terms, just tell them what they're doing. They may not even know how important what they're doing is.
Well, intercession means that you take the burden or the need of some particular situation, and you give yourself to prayer.
So when somebody wakes up in the middle of the night, I mean, like a lot of people wake up and say, well, you know, I just felt like I just need to pray for this, or I felt like, or they might have a little flash of a vision and think they're crazy or something, but it really is God. Address that kind of stuff.
Exactly.
For them.
Well, once we get tuned in to the Holy Spirit and we start letting Him speak, as I did, He gives us God's burden so that we don't always have our burden. And we begin to desire what He desires. And then He begins to anoint us to pray into being. Let's see, prayer, say it like this, that prayer is the womb. Prayer is the womb.
Yes.
That actually births these things into being. And a person as an intercessor allows himself to be that person to really birth by the Spirit of God. You know,
okay,
it's birth by the Spirit of God.
All right, I'm going to hold you here again.
Okay.
All right. You're saying that God has plans.
Mm-hmm.
Your book has destiny
here. Yeah.
God has plans upon this earth, but it takes somebody to surrender and yield themselves that could be halfway across the country or halfway across the world.
Yes.
That somebody who is yielded to God, God could put you on their mind.
Exactly.
Or me on their mind or somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
And they could birth what God has for you and bring it forth. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, it's by the Holy Spirit leading. And, you know, sometimes you feel like, oh, I'm just worried about this, or I just feel sad about it. No, really, it's the Lord putting that. The way you'll know it's a burden is if you pray, then that burden lifts, you know.
Oh, this is good.
Sometimes
people
don't know exactly what a burden is.
Yeah.
But, oh, my, I wouldn't go into the countries that I've been in with all the witchcraft and the occult.
Right.
I would not go unless I had people praying. The Lord spoke to me this word, pray there before you go there.
Oh, yeah.
And you prepare that place that you're going before you even get there, because you can run into dangers that the type dangers we don't experience here in America.
Well, just so the television audience will know, I mean, I would never even sit down and do an interview with anybody or do my own television program if it's nobody but me without having prayers here. We got prayers here in this room with us.
Thank God for them.
You know, I would never do it without them because I know that they're pushing back forces and opening and clearing avenues for us nothing else could make it work that way.
Well, prayer changes the atmosphere.
Yeah.
And I'm aware that Whole Life is a praying church. And as I ministered here Sunday morning recently, and saw how easy it was for people to hear and for people to respond, even to give their hearts to the Lord, I knew that happened because the atmosphere had been changed in prayer. You know, praying, changing the atmosphere, releases angels to do the work of the ministry and the church, to actually keep people's ears from being stopped up to hearing the truth. It's amazing, and it'll cause them to be able to, their faith to be increased as they listen.
So you're saying you and I both have been in churches, and you stand up and pray, and it's like you've hit a brick wall.
Right.
Most of the time, that they don't have that kind of a prayer coverage.
That's right.
To push back the powers of darkness that want to keep the word from going forth.
Yeah.
So that's why you, when you go, just like you say, you go into places, and it's easy. It's a joy. It's it's phenomenal to be able to pray there. Of course, your church certainly is like that, to be able to release the word. And it all is down to prayer.
Yes.
The kind of prayer coverage that church has.
Because prayer keeps the enemy from doing the things that he would do. It binds spirits. It looses the blessing of God. It clears out the path so that the enemy cannot have his way. There are all kinds of spirits that, you know, Ephesians 5 says that it's spirits without bodies that we are dealing with.
Right.
Well, we don't have to get spooky about this. This is what the Bible says.
They
are there.
They are.
You don't have to know what they are, their names or anything.
Right.
All you have to do is just keep praying, keep praising God, keep blessing the name of the Lord, and keep the atmosphere in a place where God is free and welcome to do His work.
Because the blood of Jesus is bigger than anything known to mankind.
Absolutely.
All right, you say, we've got about 5 minutes left, you said that define your destiny. Define your destiny. Now tell me what you're talking about here.
All right. Most people are aware. How many times you heard people saying, I know God has something for me.
Yeah.
God wants me to do something. And so often they'll spend a big part of their lives not knowing what that is, not being able to find the way.
Right.
Because they're not coming every day and waiting on God, having that devotional prayer life I was talking about. And then the thing they feel they should do, sometimes they want to function on good ideas rather than praying and letting God speak to them. And God will open doors.
Being led by their natural mind.
Yes, exactly.
Of the Spirit of God.
Exactly.
Yeah, okay.
So to give definition to a thing means to see it formed, to see it manifest, brought into being. So you feel that you have a destination or a destiny, but you don't sense that you're getting there. Very often it's the lack of prayer. And prayer is what the Lord has given us. So that we can get into the heavenly realms. That the subtitle of the book is Your Journey to Divine Revelation.
Yeah, yeah.
As we walk this way, God will begin to reveal the things that we need to know about ourselves, about others, and about what He's called us to. He will bring it together. We just cannot do a spiritual work by the natural.
So what you're doing is helping people know that God has a divine plan for everybody.
Absolutely.
And it's not necessarily their talents and their abilities.
No.
Because we have a tendency to think we have a talent or an ability, that must be where God wants us. And we both know that is not necessarily so.
No.
And when people think that and go that way, they can really have a mixed up life, can't they?
Yeah. Even Jesus said He did nothing but what He saw the Father do.
Right.
And one of my favorite prayers is, Lord, You know I can't do anything without You. See, I really believe that.
Oh, I'm with you. Yeah.
Okay, then when He knows that we're dependent on Him and we're obedient to what He says to us, then it opens something where we start hearing and we keep hearing. Yeah. And as we submit situations to Him, then He will begin to speak to us. That's what I talk about in the book, how that comes
that
about.
Is great.
In the book, I'll tell about a lot of different well-known people who have I've encountered in life as I've passed through this journey, and I tell interesting things about them, you know. But all of my encounters and my experiences have come about because I knew that I had to do what God called me to do through the instrumentality of prayer and no other way.
Okay, we'll have just a couple of minutes. If you know, I could, because I've read all of Dr. Curran's books, and she is a great author led by the Spirit of the Living God, and they are life-changing books. With just a minute or so left here, what would be, if you were to say to somebody, this is what this book will do for you, What would you say? Say it to them.
This book will take you wherever you are on the journey. You can be a person who knows a lot about prayer or a person who is uninitiated. This book, you'll be able to join in the journey from wherever you are. Like when I go biking, I can put in my bike at any place on the Creeper Trail and go from there. You can just jump into this journey wherever you are, and you can start benefiting by the experiences I had, how the Lord spoke to me, how the Holy Spirit trained me, and what the result is from that. You will really learn. I always, when I see people that have accomplished certain things, I always think, I wish they'd tell me how to do that.
Yeah. Oh,
and basically, that's what the book, if I could be a mentor to you in prayer, this is the closest thing to that, is finding out the steps along the way that take you into prayer that can be powerful, where you really can accomplish your destiny.
Dr. Curran, this is wonderful. I pray everybody everywhere gets this book, Define Your Destiny Through Prayer, Dr. Sue Curran. Again, she's written many books on prayer. They will change your life. And I'm just so thrilled that God gave us this opportunity to get this out, because I wish I had had this years ago. What
Me
a
too.
Difference it would have made in our life. Thank you for coming. Thank you for sharing. And I'm telling you, you ought to go on Dr. Curran's website, and you'll find out all kind of things and about their conferences and everything that's happening with them. But don't you forget it. God has a plan for your life, and He loves you, not mad with you. God bless.